Janine Cumin's novel American Dirt has been a phenomenon in the world of publishing, with huge sales and almost as much controversy. The book follows a middle-class Mexican woman as she escapes the country with her son after her husband, a journalist, is killed by a drug cartel. The story traces their often violent journey as two of the countless immigrants from Latin America who are forced to embark on a dangerous journey to the United States. The novel has been acclaimed by such figures as Oprah and Stephen King, and described by one critic as a grapes of wrath for our times. However, the plaudits were quickly followed by outrage from members of the Hispanic community, who complained that the novel misrepresents the Latin American experience. Disdain for the novel's depictions of migrants soon bubbled up on social media. Critics described it as torture porn for a predominantly white publishing industry and began tweeting out mock stereotyped stories with the hashtag #WritingMyLatinoNovel. The row over the social and cultural politics of the book has rekindled a debate over prejudice in the publishing industry and the notion of who, exactly, is allowed to tell the stories of others. Preempting some of the pushback, Janine Cumin said in a New York Times opinion piece that she did not want to write about race out of fear of striking the wrong chord, of being vulnerable, of uncovering shameful ignorance in my psyche. She said she identified as white in every practical way. I don't know if I'm the right person to tell this story. I do think that the conversation about cultural appropriation is incredibly important, but I also think that there is a danger sometimes of going too far towards silencing people. Unfortunately, mainstream fiction isn't the only battleground for these tensions over identity politics and creative license. Surprisingly, these kinds of cultural appropriation and cancel culture debates are playing out in the young adult genre more intensely than anywhere else. As the YA genre experienced a boom over the last decade, the tenor of the forums and the online communities became increasingly strident. Young adult novels in which the author shares a particular marginalized identity with their subject are tagged, approvingly, as own voices. Anything that strays from this can quickly lead to tense online discussions. There are threads devoted to vetting stereotypes and defining the standards for who can write about whom and under what circumstances. Commenters scold authors who run adrift of such standards. The authors, their reputations battered, will often retract their books from sale. Authors will release statements addressed to the community, apologizing for the problematic representation and historical insensitivities in their work, and for failing to heed the responsibility that comes with introducing readers to certain topics. Even if a new, young adult novel is steeped in diversity, it can still provoke outrage. In 2017, Kara Drake's YA novel The Continent was slammed for its white savior narrative. Drake contacted her publisher and asked to push back the publication date so she could make revisions. In early 2019, author Kosoko Jackson withdrew the publication of his debut young adult novel, A Place for Wolves. The book, following two American boys as they fall in love against the backdrop of the Kosovo War, had garnered early praise from reviewers and was bolstered by the Own Voices hashtag, which recognizes the main characters of a book sharing a marginalized identity with the writer. Jackson is black and queer. But a withering online review took issue with Jackson's treatment of the war and his portrayal of Muslims. Jackson issued a letter of apology to the book community, stating, "I failed to fully understand the people and the conflict that I set around my characters. I have done a disservice to the history and to the people who suffered." Around the same time, Emily Wen Zhao, another up-and-coming young adult author, cancelled the publication of her debut novel following a deluge of online criticism from readers over her depiction of race and slavery. Her novel, Blood Air, was a fantastical retelling of the Anastasia story. Following positive early reviews, there was a groundswell of criticism of Blood Air on Goodreads and Twitter, calling out what one reader described as the anti-blackness and blatant bigotry in this book. Negative feedback from the young adult community led Zhao to ask her publisher not to release the book at this time. She stated she was grateful to those who have raised questions around representation, coding, and themes in my book. It was never my intention to bring harm to any reader of this valued community, particularly those for whom I seek to write and empower. I don't wish to clarify, defend, or have anyone defend me. This is not that. This is an apology. While some on social media praised her decision to cancel publication, others urged her to reconsider bowing to bullying from a mob. When it comes to representation, be it young adult own voices or blockbuster mainstream fiction such as American Dirt, there are legitimate tensions about the development of certain narratives and the pathways for diverse writers. Many publishing houses now have something called a sensitivity reader, a person whose job is to vet stereotypes, scanning a book for racist, homophobic, sexist, or otherwise offensive content. These readers give feedback based on self-ascribed areas of expertise, such as dealing with terminal illness or transgender issues. This whole new career field is the result of two phenomena: a culture saturated in social media and a cultural climate in which writers are under increased scrutiny for their portrayals of people from marginalized groups, especially when the author is not part of that group. So, not only can people only write within strictly policed categories, they now also face an extra layer of editing to avoid them, or really, the publishing house, drawing any online controversy. This kind of oversensitivity and priggishness demeans everybody, the writers, the critics, and those whose outrage is performative or unflinching when it comes to holding others to account. If we'd had these kind of wrist-slapping and restrictive tendencies in the past, there's no doubt some of the most incredible fiction in the literary canon would never have been published. It's demoralizing to think how many manuscripts are out there from promising writers that are being rejected on a daily basis because they don't meet these standards of sensitivity.